How was lunch? I hope everyone is full and happy. And in that spirit, to make you hungry again, we have a cooking lesson from Toni Chang on how to make soup dumplings.
I hope we all had a good lunch, because I was told that my presentation is put after lunch for good reason. So my name is Toni Chang, and I'm a foodie. I mean, a test engineer from Google. Since part of my work is to influence test best practices, I find myself having to convince people with very different backgrounds, like engineers, engineering manager, developer relationship manager, and product managers, why we want to do component test. After repeating the basic test concept over and over again, I decided I want to make this more interesting. I'm going to use soup dumpling as an abstract example to demonstrate creation of end-to-end test case and then breaking them down into component tests. And did I mention I'm a foodie? A few years ago, I went to a really fancy restaurant and ordered my favorite food, the soup dumpling. Expecting something soft and juicy, I got something tough and dry. I went to the waitress and asked, "What is going on?" She shrugged her shoulders and said, "Sometimes good, sometimes bad." Shocked at her answer, I went to the owner. The owner is a lot more customer-centric and told her, "We are a high-end restaurant, and you need to make sure everything is of high quality before you serve." For those that is new to this food, here's the anatomy of soup dumpling. It's got really thin, delicate skin with soup and meat wrapped inside, usually served warm. The waitress took a pause and said, "I guess I can try one before I serve each plate." So each plate will need a test sample for her to try before she serve. Do you think this is gonna work? At least it won't be horrible, but there are limitations. And I see at least three. First, she won't know all the aspects to look for, so there's the lack of baseline. And then, she's got limited stomach space. So if she serves, I don't know, a plate every 5 minutes, she'll get full really soon, so this is not scalable at all. And then, if she found something that's not right with the dumpling, the customer would need to sit there and wait for everything to be remade from scratch. So the turnaround time is way too long. Fast forward a few years, I'm now a test engineer. I exist to engineer efficient and sustainable tests. How can I help? Using my learnings from software testing, let's see what I'm going to do different. First of all, I will consult the SPEC. The SPEC will spell out the different requirement and criteria to look for, which will address limitation number one. In software, we would have different documentations with varying different level of detail. Like the first column, the one-pager, has the really high-level attribute of what a soup dumpling should be like. And then in the second column, you've got the PRD, which spells out the use cases. And then in the third column, you will have the functional spec, which has the actual implementation detail. Let's use safe to eat as an example. If you would have been creating a manual test case, you can just go by the PRD, because your human tester has the cognitive ability to figure out whether something is cooked or not. Whereas if you're doing automation, you might need to spell out what cooked means to define it. Just like when you're testing software, your human tester would have the ability to figure out whether a system has been booted successfully, whereas your automation will need to look for something more specific, like what events to look for, what event constitutes to a successful boot. In this case, your functional spec has defined cooked as 180 Fahrenheit, and your automation will be happy. So, here is how your automatable test case could look like. Measure the dumpling when it comes out of the steamer and make sure that it is 180 Fahrenheit or above. And then your spec also says your dumpling needs to look pretty. And it spells out pretty as 18 folds at the top. Your automatable test case could look like validate that it has 18, count the folds and validate that it is 18. As you can see, both of the test cases no longer require you to actually eat the dumpling, so it addresses the limitation challenge. The scalability limitation. However, some of this could be difficult to validate. Say, for example, the soft and juicy criteria. The spec says it needs to be 30-70 soup meat ratio. In order to automate that, you need to first extract or validate that. You need to extract the soup, pull out the meat, weight them separately, calculate the ratio before you know that it has met that criteria. Can we do something better? Probably not with our current understanding, because we've been looking at the dumpling as a final product and have no insight into its production process. The best we know is you've got some raw material, do some auto magic, and then, boom, you have your final soup dumpling. But if we understand the actual production process, we might actually be able to do better. So let's go through this briefly. First, you make a chunk of dough, divide it into little pieces, roll them into skin, and then put some meat in there, put some soup jello in there, wrap it up, and then steam it. After you steam, the soup jello will melt to become soup. That's where you get your soup meat ratio from. And if you fill in the detail that you've just learned about in this diagram, you will see that you will understand the dumpling creation flow a lot more. Does this resemble any of your software architecture diagram? And if you look carefully, you will see that there are a few major components in there. The first one is divide. It takes in a input of a block of soup jello and output the right amount for one dumpling. The divide component takes more than one input types. It also takes in meat and output the correct amount. Your next component takes in both the soup and meat piece and mix it into become filling. As you can see, each of these components have their independent input and produces the output that is expected from them. And if you iterate through the whole process, you will see that this is how the whole flow looks like. Each of the component has a clearly defined input and a clearly defined output. And testable software design also looks like this. They have well-defined components. And you ask, how does this help me? Well, remember that last test case where you need to isolate the soup and the meat and all that? Let's see if we can do better with component-level validation. Now that you have your component isolated, you can see that the divide component is really the only one that contributes to this end result. If you can make sure that your divide component is outputting the right amount of soup jello and the right amount of meat piece, it's really highly likely that your end result ratio is going to be correct. So if you do a component level validation, all I need to do is validate that the soup jello is of X gram and the meat is of Y gram. The wrapping test case. Remember earlier you were counting the folds after it was cooked? Now that you have this diagram, you can easily see that wrapping the filling and skin is really the only component that has effect on this final result. So instead of waiting for the steam process, you can validate that it has 18 folds right after your wrapping component is complete. And as you can see, both of these test cases demonstrated how component-level tests can greatly reduce the turnaround time and identify issues earlier in the development cycle. And the last test case, remember the cook test case where it needs to be 180 Fahrenheit? With the same diagram, you quickly identify that steam is the only component that is affecting this end result. While you can validate that it has been cooked to 180 Fahrenheit, if you think through it a little bit more, your steamer is not really your system under test. If you have a reliable steamer, you should be able to know that as long as you cook it for n minutes, it will reach different temperature that you desire. So your test case can be greatly simplified to make sure it has been steamed for n minutes. Think about it in software terms. If you're able to clearly define what your system under test is and not conflate it with all this dependency, you can also simplify your test case greatly to test for only what you want to test for and not anything else. Some people say, it doesn't work for my project. My project is too complicated for it to be divided up. Or others say, that's not really testing the end-to-end scenario. Or they said, if I test all the end-to-end scenario in the world, I can cover my components anyways. Well, if you look around, component testing is actually everywhere, even when before there is software. When you go to see how kids learn gymnastics, you will see that they repeatedly stick their feet out, just that. And their instructor would tell them to correct every minor movement of theirs. And after they got that part right, they would then connect it together to become a routine. If you play in an orchestra, for example, all the individual instruments will need to make sure that their part is fluent before they combine it to become a symphony. Or if you play soccer, your coach is going to ask you to drill on independent skills like dribbling, running, even though it's covered as part of the game. So I hope you see a pattern here. Any product that is of complexity, be it a physical product like a soup dumpling or an experience like a symphony, in order to do it well, you need to break it down. Why do we think software is any different? If you're semi-convinced and want to think about implementing this, there's a ton of resources online about test-driven development, refactoring, testable design. You just need to look around and find what is right for you. And you ask, am I done with really good component level tests? Unfortunately not. Component tests is really just a stepping stone to a finer quality. It is not a replacement of your end-to-end tests. Every once in a while, you do want to eat your soup dumpling, and every once in a while, dog food your own product. Maybe just not every plate, and not every change that you make. I hope this has given you a new perspective of seeing your own product, and next time when I use it, it's sometimes good, other times also good. Thank you.
So thank you, Toni. We have a few questions for you. Is a component level test the same as a unit test?
I would see unit tests as a type of component test, but usually if you want to define it more clearly, unit test is a little bit smaller test than a component.
To what extent is component testing dependent upon service-oriented architecture? Can you component test a monolithic application?
I think component testing is dependent on a design that will allow you to be able to test things in isolation. So I would say that it is highly dependent on how the architecture is and how it's designed.
Ah, stop flipping. Sometimes your components have unexpected consequences. Say you change to a new decoration that sometimes punctures the dumpling and causes the soup to drain. How can you handle this?
I think stuff like this will be captured in the final validation in end-to-end test that you're not skipping. I think the point of component tests is really to make sure that you're catching things early that you can test on component level and not replacing things that you absolutely need end-to-end tests to cover, to uncover, like for your example.
How does this compare to the ACC methodology in the now abandoned Google Test Analytics project?
I am actually not familiar with the Google Test Analytics project, so sorry about that.
And I think we're going to call that the last question since we just have a few seconds remaining. So thank you, Toni.
Thank you very much.